you thinking about?
It's not every day you get a chance to fuck a ghost.
Something you are.
Oh man, it's getting late, guys. You better get on this podcast. Welcome everyone back to another episode of Mario Likes Movies.
Oh man, are you recording?
I'm recording.
Oh, I should pull the mic closer to me.
No, don't. You're too loud to begin with.
I guess I should stop making crinkling sounds with my potatoes.
Can you hear me from here?
Probably. Yes, I can hear you fine.
All right.
Yep, you're good. Oh, man. So, what's going on, everybody? We're here still in this place.
Yes, we are.
We're round about in a room.
I'm here live again.
Yep.
Aren't you happy?
Mario's live. I have to look at him for another week.
Aren't you happy?
I don't know about that yet. We haven't started the show. Once we start, I'll have a better idea of whether I'm happy.
Oh.
But
how about you? Are you happy?
I am. I'm good. I don't know if you guys are happy that I'm back.
I don't know about that either, but I have to say I'm happy because I have to live with her, so
that's
I'm
right.
Very happy.
You have to be overjoyed.
I'm thrilled. This is making my day.
That's right.
He just threw up a little in his mouth. Bring your wife to work week. Oh, man.
Oh. So what's happening? What's going on?
Not much. Editing's going well, kind of. Since I get people to do it for me for every once in a while.
Yeah, you do.
And
fucking leech.
Hey, it's okay because the more I see you do stuff, the more I can copy that and not have to worry about you doing it for me anymore.
He's just copying my style.
That's fine. We all got to start.
That was really funny how like we sat there for a half an hour. I chopped 5 minutes out of your shit.
Yeah,
it was really funny.
And you're like, you see how this flows? I'm like, fuck, why didn't I think of that? Oh yeah, it's because I'm a moron. Yeah, that's why.
I think it's like less painful actually when he cuts footage versus like when he hands you back a script with a big red mark on it. Like just
well again, what really helped was that he wrote that whole sequence, yeah. So it really
it wasn't so painful for you.
I think as far as like because we both wrote that episode, but like I directed and had to put that together with no time. And I think I did an okay.
Came out pretty
job.
Good. No, it
yeah.
did. Came out pretty good.
Yeah.
It did.
I you know? Stuck with his vision of what we kind of wanted to put together with the limitations I had, and I thought I did all right.
Yeah, it came out pretty good. I think it looked good.
Yeah, especially since it went from 6 minutes to like 1 minute and change. Yeah.
No, even if it doesn't look so good, at least you're not looking at it for too long.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. Even though it was a long, and like you said, your edit was up at 6.5 minutes. And then when I chopped and cut it and moved things around,
it was like 2.
It came out to 2.5.
Yeah.
Came out to about 2.5. And that's not terrible. It just means that, you know, you had extra footage that was just unnecessary.
Yeah. Not only that, the sound cues helped too.
Yes, the sound cues definitely help. Once you put the soundtrack in, you realize how fast you can move the story along just based on the mood that's being created from the sound.
Plus you can keep the viewer's attention. Time. Yeah, spanning time.
Spanning time, exactly. You can show how to span time properly. But that's all it takes. It's just to you, then it takes some time. You figure it out. Hell, I'm not fucking perfect at it either. I'm far from it. I'm far from great at it.
Well, you're pretty decent.
Well, I'm quick. I'm really fast editing. Hey, now.
Mario, hey, it's for horses. I told you that in confidence.
When were you confident in Mario ever?
It's true.
Yeah. I'm just sitting here staring at her doozers.
Doozers.
No, that's not a reference for boobs either.
No. She actually has doozers.
Actual
on her
doozers.
Arm. Actual doozers.
No, so. My boobs are called Maverick and Goose.
Do they play homoerotic volleyball together?
Wow.
Usually when I'm jogging.
I buzz the tower from time to time.
Wow. Wow. I don't know where that went, but at least we're not talking about fucking Nazi lobsters anymore.
Oh, my God. Don't. Just don't. Shut your mouth. Don't start. You sit there. You continue to laugh. We're going to move this conversation along.
I'm supposed to hear it look pretty.
Today on the podcast...
We will not talk about fish.
There's no fish. Actually, wait. Let me double check the list. No, I don't see any fish on here.
Okay, good.
I think we're pretty much good. We're safe. No fish, no lobster. There are no crustaceans on today's menu.
All right, good.
What is on today's menu, though, Mario?
I think we are discussing movies that kind of had a influence on us in the not so good way.
In the not so good way.
Yeah.
So what you're saying is these are the movies that scared us when we were kids.
Kind of, yes.
Kind of. Yes. He says kind of because Mario is incapable of sticking to the guidelines.
I really love saying let's do this and then just shattering any boundaries
doing
that I had just
everything
put forth.
But that.
I'm like, hey, Manny, let's talk about movies that are funny. Okay. You know what movie was
not funny?
Awakenings with Robin Williams. That movie made me cry.
Let's talk about comedies. Yes. And then he'll bring up Natural Born Killers. You know?
Wait, that's not a comedy?
Oh. It's funny, but... Yeah. Mario has a great, wonderful tendency of straying from the subject in every way, shape, and form. You know?
Yeah. I tend to do that. I get distracted very easily. I do actually have a form of ADD, but I don't like to say that much. But I do actually have it because as I talk, I'm texting on my phone while keeping the subject at hand. But then when I'm looking at Manny in person, I just totally forget what I had to say sometimes. Because, like, even though my attention's there, it just goes away like a bird flying.
It goes away quite often when you're not here, too.
Yeah, but I'm usually eating chicken with my hand over my face.
Did you just see something shiny and forget what happened?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, that's Mario for you.
Yeah. I'm like a bird. I only fly.
Why did we name the show after you? Oh, it was already there.
Yeah, it was already there.
It was already there, yeah.
And remember, what are we going to name the show?
See, but you know, we always mention that, too. We always get on that subject of, oh, that when we rename the show, you do realize that half hour conversation that we had about renaming the show never aired.
Fuck.
For you listeners out there, I've been building a bonus episode for a while now.
Is it just
a bunch of random conversations, like random stints that we went off on for like a half an hour,
like
20
like
minutes,
Nazi
half
lobsters.
An hour of just like Nazi lobsters. Like where it's just the conversation just went, what the fuck are you talking about? Stuff like that. Like we were talking, I think that episode when we did was it not the Nicolas Cage episode. It was the week after that.
I don't know. The last month has been a blur to me.
Yeah.
So I can't really remember.
It was I forget what episode, which one it was. It was the week after the Nicolas Cage episode. We went on for like 25 minutes of what we would rename the show. And he explained the origins of where the title of the show came from and how they did this and all that. 20 minutes taken right out. And it's going into the bonus episode. Whenever I finish the bonus episode.
I'm on the edge of the seat to find out why the show is named for Mario, who is a big movie geek.
Well, you're gonna no. There's actually a reason. It's not. It's more than just the superficial title. It's more than just that. There is a reason. You're just gonna have to listen to the bonus episode when I decide to upload it.
I'm gonna call it Dumpster Diving Special.
That's a good name for it actually, because another conversation we have like the one bonus episode
we did talk about a dumpster.
We had a bonus episode that we put up, and it was all about what a racist Spike Lee was.
Yeah, that was about 45 minutes of us talking about how Spike Lee hates white people.
Yeah, yeah, you know, and it's a bonus episode that I'm going to throw together with some narrative bits in there just to kind of piece them together and put people into perspective of what we were talking about at the time.
Yeah, because we get really really, really out there sometimes.
Yeah. That, and we try to keep the show around the 2 to 2.5 hour mark, and we've hit 3, 3.5 a couple times.
One, shit, what was the one we did almost 4 hours on? Was that with Ray? Was that the Valentine's one?
No, that was, no, it was,
it was House of Wax.
It was The Secret.
Oh, yeah.
We did almost 4 hours that night.
That was when Mario decided...
He cried for 45 minutes right in the middle. It was just...
Yeah. That was when I was sad. Like, I'm tired of being miserable, and I'm going to tell everybody about it.
Yeah, he cried.
That was therapy for me.
Yeah, he cried.
He was going to save the money from the therapist.
He cried out so much that the headphones got wet. He soaked them, and he had to go to a store get a new pair in the middle of the show. Yeah. Yeah, it was really an emotional moment.
What?
Fortunately for me, I didn't have nothing to do with it. I wasn't even there. I was AFK sandwich.
You were dead the day.
He was BRB sandwich.
Yes.
I told you guys the other day that the way I get over things is to just like lash out and say it, and I kind of did that day. So yeah.
Yeah, he just started rambling, and about an hour into it, he decided, by the way, this is a movie review.
Yeah.
Just threw it in there. And after about 15 minutes of him talking, and I realized what movie he was talking about.
And then we talked about that for 2 hours.
We had no intention of discussing The Secret whatsoever. But he just segued in, it was like a 25-minute long segue into The Secret. And then when I finally caught on to what he was doing, we went on for another 2 hours.
Yeah. And then we just cut the whole first half of the episode out. And just like, yeah.
Oh, man. Yeah, talking to him at 2 o'clock in the morning is very interesting from time to time. It's very interesting.
Because that's when I'm like half tired and I just go on about anything.
He's sitting in the car.
I'm like, you know what grinds my gears? Nazi lobsters.
Jesus Christ.
I was like, you know what I like? Vagina. And like, that's our conversation.
You know what? Two things should not be put together.
I fell in love with vagina before I fell in love with you.
Nazi lobsters and vagina should not be put together.
Yeah.
We learned that last time.
Yes.
The things that come out of this woman's mind, man. Let me tell you, you will hear it one day. But that day is
nicotine depraved brain going on. Deprived brain going on here.
No, yeah. We can't announce that because I don't want to be like jinxing.
All right, whatever. So, moving on.
Yes.
I don't know how to segue into this, so we're just going to brunt force it. Brute force.
This one time at band camp, go!
I played with a girl's small nipples and it freaked me out.
I never went to band camp.
I did.
I did.
There was a lot of fucking. And there small was. Nipples.
Never went to band camp. No.
Flute play is a thing.
I don't think you ever went to band camp. I think you're lying.
Of course I am. Why would I be telling the truth about band camp?
I went to band camp.
Sorry. Was there a lot of fucking?
No.
Damn.
They were like 9.
Ew. No, I wasn't 9. I was 14.
There should have been fucking then. Band nerds?
I don't know.
There was a lot of drama.
And musical instruments going into said places,
well, I was
right?
A flagget, so I really...
You were a what? What were you?
A flagget.
Oh, I thought you said something totally different.
I was that too. But, no, I was part of the color guard. We tossed flags.
The what?
The color guard.
Oh. Okay.
You tossed
what?
You
know, in the Macy's Day Parade when they.
This is getting wildly inappropriate.
So when the flaggets.
The flaggets toss the flag.
To the
color. The flaggets toss their flag. Yes. Toss each other's flags.
Okay.
And sabers.
The flaggets tossed each other's flags and played with their sabers.
Yes.
In the color guard.
In colored dress.
Yes.
Yes.
Sounds like a mess.
You're fired. Just get out. Bring your wife to work day is over.
Oh, I'm going. Wait, I can't go home. I am home.
Yeah, well, good. Hit the bedroom. Close the door.
Did that banned. Scare you at all? Like, performing with flaggets and sabers in front of everybody?
No. I went to Giant Stadium and did it. That was exciting.
You went to a Giant Stadium.
No, Giant Stadium, as in the Giant Stadium.
Oh, it's MetLife Stadium now.
Whatever. It was Giant Stadium back then. When I was a kid. Helping you segue again.
That's why I asked if it scared you.
I want nothing to do with this. I'm just going to wait until you guys are done and then just segue myself back into the conversation.
Well, I think we're done with the flagotry. So
I hope to God you are.
Okay. I'm not going to lie. When I do the podcast, I do one of three things. I'm either writing a script, which is hard to do while I do the podcast, but it actually keeps... When I'm like super focused, I'm usually writing. Or I'm playing Hearthstone, and that's when I'm like... So, yeah, we're talking about martyrs today and, you know, domestic violence and girls getting skinned. Oh, hey, we should talk about bees and, you know, Jolly Ranchers or something. You know, that's usually when I'm playing Hearthstone or WoW, which I don't really play anymore. And then when I'm not home in my car or in the basement of a cookie place, I am, like, sitting in this really comfy chair with my headphones on, and I just lean back and put my arm over my eyes and pretend like I'm sleeping as I talk. So I'm, like, half awake, I think. But, I mean, I like doing them in person, but then I just ramble on like I am right now, looking at the Brain People cap, and no, everybody's just looking at me in disappointment.
I'm not looking at you at all, for the record. I'm actually looking way away from you.
See?
I was just thinking about gummy bears.
We are going to talk about things that did, in fact, scare us as children this week.
Huh.
Or even maybe into our teen years, because some of us are younger than others. Cough, cough. Not by much. Lindsay's celebrating her second 29th anniversary this year, so...
29th anniversary? Who the fuck did you marry 29
her birthday.
Years ago?
Sorry. Her second anniversary of her 29th birthday.
There you go.
That's okay. Gotcha.
So that now, actually would be my third.
So now we know how old she is. Oh,
well, you just threw yourself under the bus there.
I don't
miss.
Care. I'm fucking old and I'm married and it don't matter no more.
Nope.
Guess what? I'm old and not married and it does matter to me.
That's why it matters.
Because I'm a lonely fuck.
So.
Yes.
Buttons.
Get that mother! All right, so let's kick off this topic because we're a little rough with the live shows. So
apparently so.
Well, I'm just going to ruin
here's the thing.
This one all over
when,
again.
When Manny and I are doing this weekly, he's in his computer screen and I'm either in my phone or my computer screen. And when we have a guest, they're usually with Manny, but they're drinking and they have a giant list of stuff to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
The last 2 weeks we have made half-ass lists.
That's not true. We made a list, and then we put you in charge of it.
I did try to keep it on topic last week, but I just... It was like the fucking gong show gone awry. There was no gong.
There was no gong.
So, I mean, I couldn't do anything about
Stupid!
It. It's been a while since we did a live show. But
surprise!
This week, I think...
I think we could do it this week.
Yeah.
So, movies that fucked us up when we were young. They scared us when we were little and just... took over our lives and made us never want to look at the screen again or inspired us to continue doing things with the screen in front of us, making our own movies and stop looking at me like that.
Speaking of making your own movies.
No. We're on topic here. We're finally on a topic here and here you go with your ADD shit.
I was just... I don't know what I was going with that.
No, you're not going anywhere with it.
I'm
you're stopping right fucking there. You're stopping right there, okay? You blew a flat tire and you're done. Stop.
We should have gotten food.
We did get food. We ate it already.
I know, but he said...
I still have...
He talks about chicken.
I'm still burping the Chinese food right now. I'm tasting. I've tasted. It's there.
That's nasty.
That's gross. You should edit that out.
You know what else was nasty? Men Behind the Sun.
Yes, it was. You didn't see it, though, so what would you know?
I'm going on of what you told me, so you should describe what you saw.
Oh, is that what it is? You're waiting for me to tell you?
Yeah. Segway for $1,000, Alex.
So while we were making up the list for this, we couldn't decide if we were going to do movies that scared us or movies that fucked us up. And there is a...
fine line.
There is a fine line between that. And we started with movies that were fucked us up, but then we decided that might not be... Yeah, he ruined that.
You know what grossed me out? M.D. Pope. And because it's all real stuff and it's yeah, that was the only thing that grossed me.
I haven't seen that yet.
Don't. You don't have to.
I wasn't planning on it. Good. I might, though, one day. You know.
I have it. You want it?
Next time.
You want to see people eating shit and vomit? Then seen I'll, it. Yeah. I'll.
Seen it. It's called the New York City Subway.
It's yeah.
True. Dude, come on.
People get paid to do this, though, in this.
Yeah, well. It's,
so the bums are hoping
that makes
they
it actually
too.
Less disgusting. The bums who eat their shit and everything are doing it because they don't have a choice, and that's just horrid. Yeah. These people are at least being paid for it. Divine was paid for it, so.
Yeah.
You know. So, anyway.
We all know how that ended up.
Men Behind the Sun is a Japanese film. Came out in the 70s. I think it was 78 or something.
I thought it was the 80s.
It might have been 80. Is sometime between sometime between 78 and 82.
A long time ago.
It was somewhere between 1900 and 2000.
I'm going to look it up right now real quick.
Sometime between 78 and 82. The movie came out. And it is about...
Well, Men Behind the Sun.
Men Behind the Sun. The movie is about the Japanese... squadron of doctors.
1988.
88? Wow, I'm way off.
Wait. And it's not rated and considered drama, history, horror.
Yes.
Squadron 731.
731. Yes, I was going to say 531, but 731. Squadron 731 was a squadron of Japanese doctors that during and after World War II...
They took Chinese and Russian prisoners.
Yes. They experimented on Chinese and Russian prisoners, as he just stated. And a lot of these, as we had the Nazis came here with Operation Paperclip in America after World War II, you know how the U.S. government and NASA and all them hired Nazi doctors and Nazi scientists to work for the United States and continue a lot of their research. This was the same thing, but done in Japan. A lot of their research was based on... They had a lot of really crazy experiments. Men Behind the Sun focuses on a lot of their human experiments.
Yeah.
And a lot of the experiments were like the limitations of the human body. And the movie itself is extremely gritty. Really gross. It's one of those movies that when it's over, you feel like you need a shower for watching that. You really Ew. Do. You feel dirty. You feel dirty for watching that. And not in that sexy Mr. Gray way. Like I've been sweating through my palms for this. No. In that, oh my God, that's what the inside of that looks like way.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Ew.
There are scenes, there's a scene where they have an entire room full of rats and they throw a cat in just to see what happens. And the rats tear this cat apart.
I figured the cat would get a few of them.
No. No. It was like the lobsters in the corner. This cat.
Oh, God, with the fucking lobsters.
This cat was scared for its. It knew it. It knew it. This, right now, this was revenge for every mouse it ever ate in its entire life all at once. It was like Willard.
Mm.
When all the rats went after that cat.
Crispin Glover Willard?
Yes, Crispin Glover Willard.
Okay.
Remember that scene?
Yeah.
It was like that, only in a fucking chamber. And they had this little window, and they watched it, and you just saw the cat guts hitting the window as the rats just tore it apart. There's another scene where they have, I think they're dissecting a little boy, like it's an autopsy scene.
Yeah.
They used an actual cadaver for the scene.
I'm not surprised.
From what I understand, they used a couple of real cadavers in the movie. There is another scene, probably the grossest scene of the whole movie.
Spoiler alert.
They are testing the limits of the human body in a pressurized situation. So they put this, they lay a man naked in the middle of a room, and they pressurize the room slowly and watch as his veins explode. Basically, while his body inflates from the inside out, his large intestine comes out of his asshole and expands like one of those long clown balloons and across the room and just flails about as the pressure slowly builds in the room to his explosion.
See, that doesn't sound horrific to me. It sounds like a fucking comedy show.
Wow. It's pretty fucking nasty. It's really nasty. It's really nasty. And yeah, the movie is quite disturbing. It's definitely one of those banned in a lot of countries and for good reason. I know Mario's kind of new to this extreme film thing. I've seen quite a few.
We still have to get to that episode.
Yeah, well, you're still new to it. And like I said, you're playing catch up right now. You know, I know you're watching the Guinea Pig series, and I'm telling you, that shit is those are comedies. The Guinea Pig series they're comedies. I actually don't really like any of them. I have them for the collector's sake of it, but I don't actually enjoy them. I think they're kind of stupid. I think most of them are really dumb. They're silly and stupid movies.
I thought Mermaid and a Man, that's the only one I've seen so far.
I've seen Flesh and Blood.
That was the only one I saw.
Yeah.
But I saw Mermaid in a Manhole. I say the only one I watched new. I have that and He Doesn't Die.
He Doesn't Die is so stupid.
I haven't seen that yet.
I think they're all dumb. I don't get it.
I've seen the new Bouquet of Guts and Gore. That is fucked.
I want to see it.
Well, we'll see it in a few months, but
yes, we will.
Oh,
is that the one that they're screening? I thought they were screening the other one.
I think it's going to be available there.
Okay.
So, I mean, we'll probably pick it up either way.
Okay.
But, like, yeah, it's fucked, the new one. I didn't think, it's not, like, when you talk about, like, a Serbian film, you and I have the same view of it. Like, it's a nice looking movie, but like once you see certain scenes, it kind of loses its punch because you know it's just over the top nonsense, and people are just like, oh my god, it's the worst thing ever. But then like it just becomes like a comedy of itself, and it's just shock value for shock value.
Yeah.
But Bouquet of Guts and Gore is like, it seems on paper that nothing's going on other than killing these two chicks slowly.
Yeah, you told me there is something in the end. There's like an end bit. Don't
tell also me there's I don't there's see a it. I'm not gonna also there's a piece of dialogue in the middle that is just like
a piece of
one lone thing is said and it just drives story into it, and you're just like, oh, there's more to it than just this.
Yeah,
and that's the one thing I give Biro credit for doing this, is that like he took just gore and gave it punch.
Substance.
Besides just gore, you know?
Yeah.
So, I mean, I'm kind of
that's all the original is, just gore.
Yeah, no, that's what I've seen. Mermaid in a Manhole looked... I saw the ending a mile away, but it still was pretty interesting, and it was really gross, but it was all just worms and pus and stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, but no, I like that. I mean, we'll discuss it on the Extreme episode, but, you know, since Men Behind the Sun apparently messed you up, I figured, you know, I'd try to discuss a little bit of it.
Yeah, it was a twisted movie.
I mean, because we both seen Salo, and that was... Salo, as far as, like, depravity goes, that's pretty high up there.
It is, and I found it boring, though. I thought the movie was dull. It was like, okay, so...
It's dudes torturing kids. Great.
Yeah, that's really what it was. I think that Salo is more seen by people as... nasty because it pushes their personal boundaries.
Yeah.
Not because the movie itself, I mean, the movie itself is pretty rancid, but I think mean, it's more
old
like
men making, it's old men. It's old men raping boys and girls or, you know, supposed to be young kids.
Yeah.
And then making them like rape each other and kill each other and eat their own feces and stuff.
Yeah. So, I mean, and it's more like it pushes people's personal boundaries. Watching naked 8-year-old boys running around and shit, you know, it's like it just makes people personally uncomfortable. They can't view it as a movie. They feel like it's just, I guess it's for taboo. I guess for good reason they feel dirty watching it. Yeah. Like it feels like you're watching a fucking child porn in some scenes, but it's not even that graphic. I don't think it is.
No,
I don't think it's that graphic. Yeah, they cut away from everything, you know. I think that if there was a scene like the Laura Gemser Caligula, she fucks a horse. She fucks a horse. I think that right there was crazier than Salo. Have you ever seen that one?
Caligula?
The Laura Gemser Caligula, not the penthouse one. The one with Laura Gemser. There's another one.
No, I haven't seen that
one. Yeah, it's Caligula, the Untold Story.
Mm.
Yeah, I have that on VHS.
I was gonna say that sounded familiar.
Yeah, I have the penthouse one on DVD. That's the Larry Flint, right? Larry Flint.
Yeah, the one where Malcolm McDowell.
Yes, Malcolm McDowell and Mrs. Tingle. Yeah.
Yeah.
Malcolm McDowell and Mrs. Tingle. Yeah, no, there's.
Dude, I saw a movie with Helen Mirren and Joe Pesci called Love Ranch, where she totally gets naked and she's like 68 or 67.
She's got balls
and nice cans for an old woman.
You guys are pretty screwed up.
She's already had enough of this show.
She's like, man, I like
AFK sandwich.
AFK sandwich.
It's like BRB question mark.
Be right back. Maybe. So why don't we move it over to you then? I did Men Behind the Sun. What's a movie that scared you or messed you up when you were young?
Really?
Yeah.
We're gonna open this up so I can embarrass myself.
Well, that's, you know, okay. I figure it's gonna get lighter.
My first point. People are gonna look at me and I'm gonna lose all credibility.
I think he's a fucking retard for it, but you know, he's gone on about these movies so many times before.
No, not this one. Not for
That one. You're right. That's the other series.
Yeah.
That's the other Masked Man with a Knife series.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What did you guys do when you were kids? Jesus.
What do you mean?
We're all like, let's make a list of things that scared us when we were kids. And I'm like,
No.
Do you remember Secret of the NIMH? Because that was some dark shit.
Well, that's the thing.
We're talking about like dirty movies.
Well, see, here's the thing. He said we said movies that scared us when we were kids. And then
he brought out
Men Behind the Sun.
I didn't see my own rules again.
I didn't see Men Behind the Sun until I was like 20 years old.
Oh, well.
I didn't see that when I was a kid. Men Behind the Sun when I was a kid. Oh, my God. I'm going to jump out of a fucking window after seeing that type of thing.
It's like, what that was your mom doing?
Holy shit, man. A kid watching that. Well, although, you know, that's not entirely true because I watched 555 a lot when I was young. And 555 is about a guy that kills couples and then rapes the girl when she's dead.
I saw Maniac when I was like.
I saw Maniac too when I saw Maniac when I was young too. But 555 is, see, when you're young, you don't have that scale of what's good and what's bad.
Oh, I know. Yeah, yeah.
It's just everything
is the same. Yeah.
It's a movie. Yeah. So whether or not the effects itself are good or not really don't matter. Whether the acting itself is good or not, it's just a matter of the images you're seeing on the screen.
Yeah.
So Maniac, while the subject itself can be really fucked up.
I also saw Suspiria and it's, at like 9 also.
See, that's the thing. As a kid, I can see Suspiria fucking you up more than Maniac. Because Maniac was like psychological in a lot of those. Some of the scenes were.
Also, you don't get things, yeah. You don't get things when you're younger. Because I saw Clockwork Orange and I thought it was dumb.
Yeah, exactly. Maniac is really just this greasy guy going out with all these girls and then they get naked and he stabs them. Suspiria is fucked up.
Yeah, the colors too.
Yeah, looking at it.
Yeah, the colors are scary. Exactly.
looking at it from a kid's perspective, it's like this guy, this woman is caught in barbed wire and there's maggots falling from the ceiling.
Oh, and it's relatable. There's a witch, you know, when you're a kid. Like, witches are fucking, you just got out of fairy tale.
And the skin ripping is just like so gross looking when you're
younger. Exactly. It's all those images are taken differently. Like I said, 555. I'm watching a guy have sex with a dead naked woman.
There you go.
Maniac has nothing like that. No. They imply a lot of it, but it's not actually done. You still haven't seen 555?
No.
Neither has she.
Nope.
The gore in this movie is insane.
So it's a super
the gore effects movie, the effects are incredible.
Huh.
You will watch that, like, how the fuck did they do that? You really will watch some of the shots and you'll say, I think they really cut her tit off.
I think that...
Yeah. Yes. I think that hook really did just cut through her tit.
Now I have something to look forward to, I guess.
The movie itself is absolute garbage.
Oh, okay.
The acting is some of the worst acting you've ever seen in your life. The police station... The police
can't
be station.
As bad as Vampire Dentist.
Oh, I don't know. I've never seen that. But the police station in this movie, the cops are two guys in brown suits.
Okay.
Both of them about 5 years too young to be detectives.
I was going to say, I know a movie with a brown suited detective in it.
So much worse. But that is part of the reason I gave him a brown coat.
Okay. Yeah.
The police station is a desk up against the wall. There's a chair behind it in the corner. And
what?
The
a singular missing poster.
A single, huh? No, yeah, there's like one thing on the wall. There's a chair there, and that's his desk. And his partner sits on the other side of the desk with his back against the wall at the chair. This is our police station. A corner of a white room with one desk and two chairs.
Sounds like Vampire Dentist.
Probably it. That's,
you really need to look that up. I'm not telling you anything about it.
I will. That's the police station in 555. It is some of the worst dialogue, some of the worst acting you've ever seen, but the effects in this movie are insane.
So it's October above ground. Like we said the last time. I'm gonna beat that joke like a fucking dead
you
horse.
You are. You're gonna beat it into the ground. You're gonna beat it until Fred Vogel smacks you in the face. The fuck is your problem?
I'll be like, bitch. Nah. I'll be like, hi, you make stuff.
He might send Jerry to hit you instead.
Yeah, right.
Jerry will do it for him.
Jerry's in Cherry Hill, so I don't give a fuck. So, Lynn, what scared you as a kid?
I'm kind of embarrassed to not make my life.
After that.
Do you want me to say mine, since mine's kind of embarrassing as well?
No, I'm just going to get out of the way and just be like, you know, listen, those wolves in the Disney version of Beauty and the Beast fucking terrified me.
The live action or the cartoon?
The cartoon.
Oh. Okay.
They're like the most vicious cartoon you've ever seen. Like, they're like foaming at the mouth. It's...
They were I remember those wolves like kind of tripping over each other just to, you know what though? I don't think that they were vicious. They were just
being wolves.
They were just trying to get their shot on screen.
Yeah, okay.
They just wanted a close up. Cause I remember the shot and those wolves were just each just jumping on top of each other. And it was like, I think he just wants a close up.
There was a sag bagel somewhere above their heads, wasn't there?
Possible.
Yeah,
those wolves were pretty...
Like, it was a frenzy. Like that.
It was a frenzy of wolf.
But none of them were on their backs getting trampled, right?
Not one.
Okay, and none of them cut each other's eyes out, right?
No.
You know, I don't know. Okay. I don't know.
Just wondering.
There may have been a lost paw, but...
it's quite possible.
But that leads me right into my other one, which is the Neverending Story.
Oh, really?
The Gmork.
Yes.
And why is it the Neverending Story?
That's that voice the and the Gmork. Glowing eyes and the... And then what? There was the swamp of sadness.
I am the servant of the nothing.
Man. That was terrifying. It was like... Then it leaped. It was like, no, you're just stuck in. You know, you're not coming out of that thing. You're like, you're convinced. The whole time you're waiting for it to jump out at you, and you're like, it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. It's okay. It lulls you into that safety, and then you just, and then that's it.
There was no safety with the Gmork.
Nope.
There was.
I loved the Gmork. He was so awesome. He was so cool.
These hands.
The Gmork was awesome. No, that's the rock biter.
Yeah, that's the rock biter.
These hands.
They're so.
But like you, like I think I'm trying to remember all the order now. The Swamp of Sadness. You had to get through there.
The Swamps of Sadness is where Artex died.
Yes.
Huh.
Which was terrifying, and like all those.
Yeah, that was like right in the beginning.
Yeah.
That was near the beginning of the journey.
Okay.
The fighting beats the sadness, Artex.
Yes. That's, yeah, that was right at the beginning. That scared me, too. Like, you're just walking, and then...
That's, like, the saddest moment in movie history right there. Artex dying. Oh my God. You know why? Because you... But you know what? It's something that you don't really... You just think, okay, the horse is sinking, and the kid is... No, Artex, don't sink into the... But then when you watch it, and you realize it in context, and think about what they're saying, the Swamps of Sadness got to the horse.
Yeah.
In other words... The horse knew he was dying.
And he gave zero fucks.
Yes. This horse actually became conscious of his own existence and decided,
fuck it.
Fuck it. I'm going to die. The horse chose death because he was so sad. A horse has chosen death.
And like,
and you know what Atreyu said
is,
as he was crying? Be like, why the long face?
Oh.
Too soon. Too soon.
TSUN, you know what it is? Like soon. When you're a kid, you were like, go a horse. And then you're like, Mr. Ed. And Mr. Ed was always so happy. And he sang songs. And it was nice.
Yeah, this horse was actually legitimately depressed.
Fuck life. That's
the horse let himself drown.
What a
bitch.
He
could have just kept walking and probably walked right the fuck out of there.
Yeah.
It's like, but Homer, how are you going to get out of the tar? Well, I'm going to pull my legs out with my arms and my arms out with my face. And that's what happened. And Atreyu was like, don't go. No.
How was it? Like, you're watching this boy, like his puppy is dying or something.
And then dead Jonathan Brandis was like, yes.
Okay, that's too soon.
Oh, it wasn't Jonathan Brandis in the first one.
I forgot.
No, but it's still too soon.
He's been dead forever.
Shut up. I will mourn him for a lifetime. Sorry.
I don't like making fun of dead people, so I'm sorry. Legitimately.
Really? Because you've done it quite often recently.
Nah. Just dead lobsters.
You just made fun of Jonathan Brandis and Artax.
Yes.
Artax is a fuck, all right? He got sad and emo and died in fucking oil that he could have pulled himself out of. But instead he's like, nope, I'm going to drown in oil because I'm a little dumbass. That's what happened with Artax.
No, it was like CutiePie411 was like, hey, you should just kill yourself.
It's like, and you fail like, as a horse. You need to just stay in the oil of sadness. The oil of sadness. That is your fate.
Wow.
No, so back on topic.
Emo petroleum.
I think the Neverending Story was like a terrifying thing as a kid.
The Gmork was awesome.
The wolf was
scary.
But no. I will get a Gmork tattoo one day. I will. Them fucking Gmork is awesome.
But like the nothingness?
Is that like
the
Gmork
nothing
and Mini?
Is amazing. That is so... It's such a profound thing, the nothing. The nothing is like this thing that has been created based on the loss of the imagination of the children of the world.
Yeah.
Children have so little imagination left in them that there's just no dreams left anymore. That's what the nothing is. There's no dreams. There's no stories. Why? Because comic books and video games that go beep, 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 beep. That's why.
Yeah.
And now, cell phones.
Yeah.
Yep.
Put it the fuck down, Mario. Jesus Christ.
God, you are just powering the nothingness.
You're giving the nothing strength, asshole.
No, I'm not. The nothing is a bitch.
You're a bitch.
He's a wolf.
You're a bitch. No.
He's not the nothing.
No. The Gmork is not the nothing.
I forgot. I have them mixed up. I haven't seen that movie in a really long time. I almost bought the Blu-ray for $8 at Walmart.
You should have.
The $7.88. And there is a combo pack of 1 and 2 somewhere, like the $7.88 Blu-ray. I want to get that.
The second one is not as...
stupid.
Yeah, no, the first
Your
one...
Your face. Falcor just looked terrible in the second
he
one.
He did. Yeah. Falcor's like my boy.
Like they turned him into a giant poodle.
I'm going to have a Falcor
I understand he's the dog-faced dragon. He's a dog-faced dragon. That's he's what he...
I blame Jonathan Brandis.
But he's still dog-faced. He's a dragon with a dog's face.
Jonathan Brandis.
Yes, he's a luck dragon.
Stop talking about Jonathan. I will fucking kill you.
And then in part two, he's just a fucking flying poodle.
Yeah, he was a flying poodle in the second one.
It's like Alpha from Avatar. Oh, I guess I'm the only nerd who watched that.
No, it was nothing like that. It was fucking Falcor, and they made him a flying poodle.
I was talking about The Last Airbender, not the James Cameron.
Falcor, flying poodle.
Atreyu.
Attacks, please!
But no, as a kid, like that fucked me up because it was like
that's a sad thing for a PG PG movie.
It wasn't even like just the horror, but it was like the nothing. Like,
I don't know. Yeah.
Oh, you're a kid. How do you wrap yourself around? Like,
you don't. That's exactly it. You don't.
Coming,
and it's like, one of those things.
This big black cloud of nothing is coming.
Yeah,
for
it's
you.
Not even
and it's like,
something.
How do you
it's
even
nothing.
Stop that? There is no stopping the nothing.
Yeah, it wasn't it's something.
Called,
it was nothing.
It's called have a met.
Like, there's no space. There's no air. There's nothing.
It's a black hole.
It's all nothing but one grain of sand. With Tammy Stronach.
Yeah, she was hot.
I want to smash my face against this microphone so hard.
Ow! 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 It fell. Look what you did. Go sit in the corner in your room. Damn
it. You should just kind mute his microphone and then tell him that his microphone got
ow, okay, I get the point.
I was the butt of that joke. No one saw it.
No, they heard it.
You hit me in my face for radio.
Yeah, so I'll kick off my movies that scared me when I was kid.
Movies that scared
when
me
I when was, I was kid. When I was young child.
It the is like bull. It is like animal. I watch movie. It like animal scare me.
Yes,
like wolf.
Like wolf.
Like pack of wild wolf.
Fucking scary.
Anyway, I'm gonna have to go with John Carpenter's The Fog, a classic Fog. That I love now. But when the semen comes out
phrasing.
And lands on Jamie Lee Curtis's back,
phrasing,
I got a little scared.
Phrasing,
because I did not see an eyeless corpse ever up until that point, and I was only like 4 or 5, if I recall. And I saw it on Channel 11.
Really?
WPIX.
You know, oh, man. Everybody saw every horror movie on Channel 11.
This was during WPIX the day.
WPIX was the greatest channel in existence. But you know what's funny? I didn't actually see The Fog until I was like...
way older.
17, 18.
Yeah, I saw... See, it wouldn't have bothered me had I... But
no,
I saw...
Of no, I, of course not.
You know, like, because it was the first, like, ghost movie I really saw. I had seen Ghost Story, but I didn't really... comprehend it like we discussed. Like, I didn't get the movie fully until I saw it later on in life. The Fog had the creepy beginning, and that kind of got my blood going. I was like,
the music,
why is all this
music
stuff?
The
that was the first time music got like chilled my bones as a little child. It was like that
that piano scared me, and the watch, and it was just a perfect atmosphere, and it was broad daylight when I saw this, and then the fucking body landed on her, and that was it. Yeah. I was fucking freaked. Done. And then the eyes at the end, fuck that. I was like, shit, I slept in a pitch black room with my grandparents when I was like four. I was like, I'm gonna see those fucking eyes in the dark ass closet where the monster that wants to eat my feet sleeps at night.
They just wanted their Masonic.
I was like, fucking Captain Blake and his leper pirate ghosts are gonna totally come and steal their fucking big gold cross from me that I don't have. I was so afraid of that shit when I was younger.
The dead are in the fog.
But now I love that movie, even though it's a piece of shit.
It's not a piece of shit.
The story is a little out there, but I still love that movie.
The dead are in the fog. The dead are in the fog.
That was a remake. I was just like, I refuse to get behind this remake, and it was so bad.
It was terrible.
Yeah, it was so bad.
Now, the first time I saw The Fog, I think I saw a reference to it in some cartoon, like Tiny Toon Adventures. And they made a joke about, there's something in the fog. And I actually, like, looked it up, and I found the fog, and that's why I saw it. And I wish I hadn't have done that. I wish I had just left it in Tiny Toon Adventures.
I wasn't a Halloween fan my entire life. I liked Halloween 3, never liked any of the others. And when I was young, Escape from New York kind of bored me, you know?
Yeah, I get it. Yeah. John Carpenter, yeah. You don't like John Carpenter.
No, not that I don't like him. I didn't, which is why I never watched The Fog. I was
You're like, it's going to be another whatever.
It was, yeah, exactly.
But what about The Thing? Three... Did you watch The Thing? And...
Yeah, but I didn't know that was John Carpenter.
Oh, what about Prince of Darkness?
I didn't realize that was
I didn't
him.
See... I didn't...
Saw Prince of Darkness, another one I didn't see until I was older.
I'm not really a big fan of Prince of Darkness.
Yeah, I'm not crazy.
I like the idea. It's just, that's one of those movies where the ending, like, didn't grab me like it should have.
I have the DVD, but I've never seen it unedited. Like, I saw it on TV.
I've never seen it.
So I've never seen it. I have the DVD. I've never opened it.
No.
Here's the thing. Prince of Darkness is this idea where Satan is a liquid in a jar. And I mean, it sounds stupid, but it looks really cool. But the way he possesses people is kind of stupid and hokey. And it's just like, okay, he made this movie for literally no money. And like, I didn't like it.
Though, too.
But the thing is, like, I know Andy's going to listen to this and like want to punch me in the face the next time he sees me, because Prince of Darkness is like his number one.
Louis, too. Louis loves Prince of Darkness.
I can't stand it. And the thing is, the acting was really good in it, but like, it fell flat to me. Because, like, I love the... I saw it late in life. Maybe I seen it when I was an early teen. I might have liked it a little better, but I just...
I saw it later as well. I didn't see it when I was
young. And that was when I was really into the satanic stuff, and that was John Carpenter's, like, Satan movie, and it still was just,
I think I saw that around the same time The Ninth Gate came out.
I'm a huge Ninth Gate fan.
I am, too, which is why it was like, fuck, Prince of Darkness, Ninth Gate, man!
Yeah, it was all about...
But I remember Polanski Mark, too, so... Yeah. But that's why I never watched The Fog.
Yeah.
Because it was just like, well, Escape from New York was kind of dull, and I don't like Halloween, and I know he didn't do Halloween 3. So to me, it was like, well, it's just going to be another fucking pile of John Carpenter crap.
Precinct 13 was good though.
I saw that young too.
While
I didn't see that 13. Because it was you know what it was? It was an old action movie.
Yeah.
To me. And I just didn't care for that. I liked horror movies. I've always have, and I'm just a horror movie guy. You know? I was very prejudiced. I was prejudiced against John Carpenter without actually having seen much of his movies. But I think it was about 14 or 15 when I realized that he was the guy who did The Thing. And I was like, oh, okay, so he has done some cool shit. You know?
I'm a fan of most of his work. Not by default either. Like, I just actually genuinely like a lot of his movies. I think In the Mouth of Madness was a step in the right direction.
I loved Mouth of Madness.
I didn't think it was fully executed. I think because I read up about the movie, they pulled a lot of the funding from it after it started rolling.
That might be when I realized that he did The Thing.
Well, In the Mouth of Madness.
I'm thinking about it now, and I think I saw Mouth of Madness. I liked it. And then I said, oh, it's John Carpenter. And then I looked into some of his other stuff, and I realized The Thing was him as well. Okay. And
The Fog.
And then The Fog, which I saw a couple years later. You know, so it was like, okay, so he didn't just do this crap. Wes Craven was another one.
I was a big fan of his stuff.
I liked Nightmare on Elm Street. And then I saw Shocker, which
Shocker sucked. Is probably my favorite Wes Craven movie.
But it sucks. It's terrible.
It's terrible, but it's a fun movie.
See, but that's the thing. It was going Nightmare on Elm Street,
that's on
Shocker.
That's on my list of bad movies you have to see.
And what's that other one that he did?
Remember that audience so
psychic,
I don't forget it.
With the psychic power. The psychic...
You know, it's an underrated movie that you reminded me of? The First Power with Lou Diamond Phillips.
Oh, my God.
That movie's so terrible.
You got your thing up there. Look up Wes Craven's movies.
Okay.
Pull up IMDb. Look up Wes Craven. He did this one. I can't remember the name of it. It's two words. Title is two words.
Not Red Eye.
No. It came out in the 80s. It's terrible. But I remember seeing this. Okay, I saw Nightmare on Elm Street. And then I saw Shocker. And then I saw this movie. And I saw something else that he did. And I was like, this is such garbage. How is this guy like considered the greatest? And then I saw People Under the Stairs. Yeah. And then I saw The Serpent in the Rainbow. And then, somewhere around that time, I saw Last House on the Left.
Okay, here we go. Last House on the Left, 1972.
Uh-huh.
The Fireworks Woman.
Never saw
The Hills Have Eyes, Strangers in
and
Our
I
House.
Saw Hills Have Eyes. Yeah.
Deadly Blessing. Swamp
Deadly
Thing.
Blessing. Okay. I was all right with Deadly Blessing. Mm-hmm. That wasn't great, but it wasn't.
Invitation to Hell. A Nightmare
Invitation
on Elm
to Hell. Holy shit, was that a pile of trash?
Yeah.
Chiller in 85, then Deadly Friend, Serpent in the Rainbow, Shocker, Night Visions, People Under the Stairs, New Nightmare.
Night Vision sucked too. I didn't like Night Vision either. And that's why, I'd seen his bad movies. And I was like, what is this shit? So I'd seen Carpenter's bad movies too. Ones that I just didn't enjoy from him. And Wes Craven and John Carpenter were not two names that I gave a shit about when I was young.
Yeah.
When I was young, it was Clive Barker. It was David Cronenberg. Toby Hooper.
Wes Craven and John Carpenter have directed the same amount of movies. 29.
Toby Hooper, George Romero a little bit, because Monkey Shines and Two Evil Eyes. Oh, man.
Monkey Shines is fucking...
I love that. Of course, bringing to my movie, George Romero, Creepshow. One of my favorite movies of all time. Scared the shit out of me when I was young.
Really?
The music.
Yeah, okay.
It's the music. The dun 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 dun.
Creepshow
dun,
2 scared dun, me a little dun. Bit because the body with the car was like I've never seen
thanks for the ride, lady.
I've never seen a zombie talk.
Yeah.
Really?
No.
And then the fucking oil slick.
And
was
when he
all
spoke it was like
yeah, when he was just pieces ride, like lady. Yeah.
Yeah.
That kind of creeped
like
me out.
Like that windshield wiper like severed his vocal cord.
Yeah, the first Creepshow did scare me when I was young. I can probably put myself in the state of mind, like if I put headphones on and watched it, and I really zoned out to it, I could probably still scare myself with it, just because of the soundtrack. I thought that piano was some of the creepiest, scariest shit ever. I absolutely...
Creepshow 1.
You know, and the jump scares are done so perfectly. Like, even when you know that they're coming,
yeah,
you know, it's still like perfectly timed. It gives you just enough wait time, you know, where you're just about to break that edge of, oh no, they're not going to make you jump. You know?
But they do it anyway.
Like, you're waiting for, here it comes, here it comes, here it... Oh, maybe they're not coming. Oh, fuck, there it is! Yeah. You know?
That was one of the first movies that did the delayed scare, was Creepshow, in my opinion. Because, like, it was... Creepshow was ahead of its time.
Big time.
There's, like, certain movies, like we discussed with Fear and Loathing. Like, I prefer it digital, but that's just me. But... That we were discussing yesterday.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But Creepshow was ahead of its time.
See, Jordy Verrill didn't get me. I always thought the Jordy Verrill story was...
It's silly.
Was dumb. I thought it was so
it's
out
the only
of,
one that doesn't fit.
It doesn't fit at all.
No. The only hint is that he killed his father.
and maybe that's why.
But they didn't say anything about it.
No, it's just alluded.
They're not. It's not even alluded.
His father like appears because he's dead and then he's dying.
Yeah.
I don't know. That was always my
human dead. Christ, 3 years almost, and that's it. Yeah. Like, daddy died. Yeah. But, like, every one of the stories in Creepshow is about somebody getting their...
justice.
Getting justice. And he didn't do anything wrong. His only crime was just stupidity.
And greed.
But he didn't even go through with
it. No. It was like dreams of greed.
But, like, who else who wouldn't think of that?
Yeah.
He wasn't even like he wanted $300, you know? He wanted $300 to pay off his bank loan.
Bad hygiene.
Yeah.
He never should have put that finger in his mouth.
You know? Yeah. He wanted $300 to pay off his bank loan. He didn't want $1,000 to live.
He didn't want $1 billion.
Yeah, he wanted $300. He would pay off a fucking bank loan or something, and that was it. There was nothing. He was just an innocent, simple guy.
Yeah.
But the truth is, the only reason that story was in there is because the raft was too long.
Yeah.
The raft of part two was written for part one. And raft it was fit and better. It was too. It would have fit better, but it was either the raft lengthwise. Or the crate. Yeah. Lengthwise, it was one or the other.
And the crate.
And the crate was so much better.
Yeah.
That creature, the Father's Day creature and the creature in the crate scared the hell out of me when I was young. Because I had those stairs.
Yeah.
I had stairs like that with the open... With the open, I mean, we all had those when we were young. We all had those open stairs in our basement. You know, when the lights were out, you swore a hand was going to come through them or something, you know? And I'm watching Creepshow all the time, one of my favorite, and I'm just seeing that creature living under the fucking stairs.
The fucking little monkey Tasmanian devil fucking thing.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
See, the worst of my stairs is when we moved to the bigger house. The stairs suddenly had a landing that pivoted. It's like, you know, you got to the landing and then you had a turn.
Yeah.
So you were always convinced that there was something at the top of that fucking stair, but you're walking like in this.
You can't see.
And you're focusing straight, so you, until you turn, you won't know if anything's there.
So if there's someone with an axe,
yeah,
you're dead.
You didn't see them until you were there.
Until you were turning face first into the axe.
Yeah.
So what's next on your list, miss?
Mine's kind of...
started with an music. Animated.
I know. Now it's just gonna get worse. Now we're going in back into puppets. But the Fieries, you know, in Labyrinth.
Oh man, you're going all like kid friendly.
Jim Henson is like her favorite,
they scared the hell out of me.
It's so funny how like the things that scared us when we were young are
you
now
just
like
cling to them.
They're our favorite things.
Like those things, like they sang and they took off their heads and then they
it
just
was
sang
creepy
some
when
more.
They took off their heads and just and, started kicking it around.
And it was like, physics, this shouldn't work. Your head shouldn't be able to come off and spin all around. And how is this happening? Because it's happening in front of me. And
string theory.
Yeah, string theory. That was exactly it.
Movie like, magic also, since you wanted to talk about it. There
I
you go.
I do want to talk about movie magic. But I think it was like, you know, I grew up a little safer, I guess, than you guys did, where it was like, I actually had a mom that patrolled what I watched, and you know there was no sneaking around my mom. Like there was one TV, and she monitored it, and you know it was kind of like, yeah, I didn't get to see the scary stuff until I was much older.
Yeah, but sheltered. Sarah's like that too. Sarah hasn't seen a lot of, not because she couldn't or wasn't allowed. I think she just never got around to seeing a lot of the crazy stuff.
Well, I mean, I was the active kid where it was like, you know, one sport after another. You know, Monday it was volleyball, Tuesday it was basketball.
Did you play field hockey?
No, I did not play. I fear field hockey girls. They scare me.
Then you weren't a sports player.
I was a sweeper in soccer.
Okay, you were a sports player. I was like, when girls like, yeah, I played sports in high school. I'm like, did you play field hockey? No.
Yeah, field hockey girls are a whole different breed. They're the only thing, really. They
That's
scare
like,
me.
They like those people.
They don't do that anymore.
They might
in high
as well
schools,
play rollerball. You know?
Right?
You know?
Yeah.
Because it's fucking dude.
Like
that,
they grow up and they play. They're derby girls.
You
like,
know,
that's it.
Field hockey was where shit when girls had problems with each other
yeah.
in high school. That's where they fucking.
That's
had
where
their
shit
fights,
got worked
was
out.
In field hockey yeah.
with that little wooden thing with the.
Yeah.
Little, yeah.
The little fucking abortion
hooked,
hook.
The little hooked the wooden thing. Oh my god,
the
man.
Abortion hook.
That's what it is. It's a wooden fucking like German abortion hook. It's just like. Brr.
Yeah. So I almost broke cheerleading in my school. Because I dropped a girl purposely on her face for kissing my boyfriend.
So, besides that, that scared me right there. Fuck what I was about to say next.
The field hockey girls are me dropping a cheerleader on her face.
Halloween 4. I saw in the theaters.
This is the one I want to punch him in the face for.
Yeah, it's so dumb because, like, I love Halloween 4 and 5.
Yeah, you're an idiot.
But, like, the ending, I'm going to spoil it. Michael Myers just gets away. And the thing is, it's like, he got away in part one. And you're like, I shot him 6 times. You know, like, it just,
and
he, like, just
got up and walked away.
That wasn't.
Just wiped that shit off. And
that wasn't scary to me. You know what was scary to me? Danielle Harris crying in an empty, dark house with Michael Myers on the loose. That fucking scared the shit out of me. Because it's like, oh my God.
No, I can agree.
The boogeyman chased me, and I killed him, and I got up after I woke up from being knocked out, and he's fucking gone. And, oh yeah, I'm in the middle of a dark fucking house by myself.
See, I can't agree with that specifically for the movie, but I can agree with the sentiment you're discussing.
Yeah.
I can agree with the sentiment, because that's how Halloween 3 ended. And that had the same ending. And the same thing. With him just screaming to stop. Stop it. Stop the commercial. Stop the commercial. And it kept playing.
Yeah, it's like...
And the movie ends dashed. And it's like, did you literally just kill every child in America? Like, you think about it, they stopped the commercial on one channel.
That is some fucked up.
They stopped it on the second, but the third one kept going, and it ended with it with that commercial airing.
Hopelessness, yeah.
Yes, every kid in America just turned into a snake.
Or had a head full of cockroaches.
Yeah, every kid in America's head just exploded and turned into a grasshopper.
It's almost time, kids. The clock is ticking. Be in front of your TV sets for the horrorthon, and remember the big giveaway at 9. Don't miss it, and don't forget to wear your masks. The clock is ticking. It's almost time.
Happy, happy Halloween, Halloween, Halloween. Happy, happy Halloween, Silver Shamrock. Happy, happy Halloween, Halloween, Halloween.
You know, when you're a kid and you're younger, you're like, that dark house is, it's the most terrible, like, when you've seen even, like, one horror movie, that dark, empty
in a dark, dark room.
That's what I was trying to go for, it's with, like, spies. That's the worst. I told you that, yeah. It's just, like, a dude in a fucking unknown, dark-ass fucking place, and you're just like, what is going on?
That was
I
the
love
worst.
Shit like that.
I had a when I was older. Before my first babysitting experience.
Oh man, makeouts, sex, and killers, IRL.
No, yes. When they put on the original "When a Stranger Calls."
Yeah. Oh my God.
That was fucking
First 10 minutes of that movie is like the most frightening thing.
Gut wrenching, bad shit.
Holy shit!
I got the vapors just thinking about it.
Wow.
That's that, another one I
that
forgot
is
about.
I'm so glad you brought that. Is the most that is the most frightening opening scene of a movie ever.
See, for
I
me,
don't think
it would...
anything tops that. No. That's like. Holy shit.
No, the worst part of it was the double whammy where it was like I saw it literally the night before my first babysitting gig. Oh, and I'm watching an
you
infant.
You just did it to yourself.
And so it was like, literally, it was like really super simple. Just do your homework. There's like food in the kitchen. It's like fine. You know, just check on the kid every once in a while. Make sure it's sleeping. And then
order pizza, do your homework, watch TV, die.
Yeah.
If you fuck somebody on the couch, like, just clean up the stain and make sure you spray some Febreze or something.
And the phone rang, and I refused.
Vagina odor.
I refused to answer the phone. Like, the phone would ring, and I was like, nope, nope. If there's a killer in here,
you know,
I don't want to know.
People have made fun of that line, and it's still, if you watch it without it being trying to make fun of it, it's still like
it is. It's
terrifying.
It's frightening as hell. It's frightening as hell.
It's one of the few.
Take it seriously while you watch it. Just don't laugh at it. Just like, okay, take it for what it is as, you know, get that's over the fact that it's old and it's a little cheesy and just get over that and just watch it for what it is. Though,
that movie still holds fucking water.
That's what I was just going to say. Like, we were talking about, like, how horror movies don't hold up with cell phones. That one still does.
That's in my top 10 all-time actual scariest.
Because he actually could be calling.
Because he actually now could be calling from inside the house.
From his fucking cell phone. He'd be calling from under the house. He'd be calling from the fucking closet.
Yeah.
That is frightening. That is a frightening fucking thing. You know, I know you and Ray always talk about the ultimate home invasion movie.
Oh, my crawl space movie.
You and
Ray
always talked about wanting to make that crawl space movie of somebody living under your house unbeknownst to
they
you.
They did that. It wasn't crawl space. It was Gary Busey.
There's one called Crawl Space, and it's a person living in the attic of the house.
There's one with Gary Busey that he's like a psychopath or
something. Yeah, there's Bad Boy Bubby too, and there's a couple different.
There's a movie called Crawl Space.
Yeah, as I said, there's one. Crawl Space is the person lives in the attic.
Yeah,
there's quite a few of them actually, and I always kind of was like, well, how can you do it? I didn't think it was really that scary of a thing. Of all the years of just thinking about it, I've said to myself, wow, you know what? That actually is quite fucking scary that there's somebody in your house and you don't know it.
Like the hotel video we were watching.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Have you seen that shit? There's this girl who did this investigation at the Carter Hotel in Manhattan.
Okay.
All right. The Carter Hotel has this history of this extremely violent history. You know, dude, you're gonna want to listen to this.
I'm listening.
Stop.
I'm not doing anything. I'm my head's in the game here.
No,
okay?
It's not.
Yeah, it totally is.
So the Carter Hotel has this really violent, dark, and disturbing history.
Okay.
You know,
is this Manhattan or?
Yeah, it's in Manhattan.
Okay.
In the 70s, it was bought by this Japanese guy, and basically just let the hotel fall into disrepair. Didn't give a fuck about it. Didn't fix anything. It's a flea bag piece of shit. Hotel.
Okay.
All right. There was like a year after he bought it, a guy beat his 25-month-old child to death in the room. There was a woman, it was a pregnant woman who was thrown out of a window, thrown out of one of the top floor windows.
Okay.
You know, there were murders and prostitutes killed and shit. This was like, everything you heard about New York in the 80s, all the violence and the killing.
Happened at this place.
Yes, exactly. This place like personified all of those horrible, horrible things about New York in the 80s. So she did. This girl did these two videos where she was visiting the hotel. And one of them, she just kind of moved the camera around the hallways and everything. And there was just this text on the screen explaining the history of the hotel. And it was really kind of creepy, just, you know, doorknobs and weird windows and
now she wasn't
dark.
Ghost hunting, right?
No. Like she was just, yeah, she was just videotaping. Like I said, the second video is her staying in the hotel. She goes into the room and she's looking at she pulls up the mattress and there's like blood stains on it and shit. It's so nasty. Like the place is disgusting. There's fucking broken everything here.
Is it abandoned or is it?
No. It's she rented a room in the hotel.
It's still okay.
She was actually staying in another hotel and just rented a room there just to be there, just to stay for the night. And she didn't actually stay in it for the night, but she went in there. She turned the shower on. The water came out fucking nasty and like red
brown. And
black, like when the water came out, she started gagging.
Okay.
It must have like smelled on top of the way it looked. It must have had a scent to it. You know, the fucking, it looks like the garbage pail is just covered in grime. Everything is disgusting. The toilet's nasty. Total fucking flea bag, disgusting ass motel. She's walking around and she's like, the place is like, I'm assuming she didn't say it, but I'm assuming just from the silence of the hotel, it's just made it really, really kind of creepy.
The feeling.
Yeah. She just felt like this is not a safe place to be.
Okay.
Around 12 o'clock at night or so, she says, I'm going to go back to my room in my other hotel. Cause I just don't feel like I should be. She's talking into the camera at this point. She says, I'm feeling a little scared and nervous to be here right now. So I think I'm going to go back to my room. And it says over the thing, 2 a.m., I go back to my room in the other hotel. 9:30 in the morning, she comes back to the Carter Hotel to check out. So she goes back up to the room, and she says, and she videotapes it. She walks in, and somebody was in the room. Not still there. She walked in. There's toilet paper in the toilet. There's like towels that would been used. Somebody had physically been in the room between when she left and came back, used the bathroom. And she's just sitting there. She's like, I just want to videotape this and show everybody. I didn't use the toilet. I didn't touch anything in here. I didn't use anything. And then she stops talking and she starts moving the camera around the room. And like the words on the screen said, I suddenly felt the need to videotape the room because I felt like I wasn't alone. She felt like there was somebody still in the room. And she recorded that and then she left. Now, how fucked up was that? Imagine if she had stayed in that room.
Ugh.
Somebody came in.
Could have been housekeeping.
No. No. No, when you look at the hotel, there's no housekeeping.
Yeah, no, she explained, like, afterward that she went downstairs to check out, and the guy who checked her out at the counter
was delighted.
So delighted that she actually checked out and returned her key.
Delighted that she returned her card key for the room and actually checked out. Like, nobody does that. She had the feeling that they don't actually code the card keys, so any card key can open any room in the hotel.
Man, that's like, fuck.
Yeah.
That was just this girl, and two of us are sitting here watching this like, so utterly creeped out at the fact that she came back 6 hours later and saw that somebody was in the room.
Well,
and
she and also, that
feeling.
She also insinuated that one of the bellhops or one of the guys behind the counter had a crush on her, clearly. And had handed her...
Yeah, what did he say? What was it?
I don't even remember. He liked her hair. It was some creepy, like, comment. And then he gave her this strange thing that was in his pocket.
Oh, yeah. Just after the bellhop was in the... She saw the bellhop in there, and she said he was missing front teeth.
Mm. Oh, God.
Clearly had a crush on her.
Yeah, clearly had a crush on her. And she said, yeah, something about her hair.
Which he is said, creepy.
Like, she had, like, the greatest hair or something like that. I forget what she said. Yeah, like, he complimented her hair, and then he pulled a piece of chocolate out of his pocket and gave it to her. And she held it to the camera, this chocolate. She's like, this chocolate that's probably been in his pocket for the last 7 years. It's all crushed.
Yeah.
It's still in the tinfoil wrapper, but it's all crushed. Like it was melted at some point. Yeah. And
got hard again.
And, yes. Yeah. She's like, so I'm now going to take this date rape chocolate that he gave me and threw out. And you start to say to yourself, I think that fucking bellhop went into her room looking for her.
For her. Figuring that
he could just get her. Into the yes, he yeah. Maybe he actually did try to drug her and was going into the room. Oh my God!
But it's like you just have like such trust in like the hotel system where it's like they code these keys.
And she said she's like, I don't think they coded this key at all. So every card will open any room in the hotel.
Huh. I wouldn't.
She was walking around the hallway. Like she said, she heard something and ran into the room, and it didn't help her feeling of. She went into the room, and it's like, I don't feel any safer being here than I am in the hallway because here I'm cornered, you know.
Christ.
Oh, there was a hooker. Somebody killed a hooker in one of the rooms,
yeah.
And the maid found it like 12 days later under the mattress.
Oh, Jesus!
In one of the rooms, like. This is how fucked up shit that's happened at this hotel over the years.
I assume that was more recent, too.
That was like 99 or so.
Oh, okay. That's still kind of recent.
Yeah, it is. Well, no,
for something like that to happen, like, you know, because that probably happens all the time, but it doesn't make news anymore.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's one of those little like blurbs on the nightly news. Oh, hooker was killed in a hotel. Who gives a fuck?
Well, no, it was like
who gives a fuck? Another plight to society. Just eliminated.
It gave you that feeling of like, you know, why when we were growing up, like, you know, on Jersey, when your parents are like, you're not going into New York City.
Yeah, like, dude. Like it's, New York was bad when we were young.
I know. I lived here.
Yeah.
And it was like our parents were like, no, New York City is off limits. It's so bad. You're going to get raped and killed and shot. And then they're going to cut you into little pieces and feed you to the fish. And then you're going to get like the fish are going to swim back to New Jersey and spit you out back here. You know, it was like ridiculous the fear that they had of New York City. But it was like that was the feeling of this hotel. It was like when New York was bad.
Yeah. And it's still like that to this day, I guess.
No.
Not New York, I mean the hotel.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. The hotel is one of the last few remaining pieces of that New York City.
Yeah, I can imagine. So what's next on your list?
Oh, Jesus.
Do you have it?
Let me grab the pad.
Really? You couldn't keep the conversation going long enough? I was out of the room for a minute.
A minute.
Well, we were talking about how the hotel is one of the last... She said it's one of the last few relics of old New York, is that hotel.
Like that feeling.
Yes. Oh, yes.
Yeah. There's like maybe like three dive bars and then that hotel.
Yeah, it is. It's one of those of old, and disgusting,
they've closed
horrible New York.
Grimy New York City, yeah.
Yeah.
Like Jason Takes Manhattan, New York City.
Like the Warriors, New York City.
Yeah. Like Street Trash, New York City.
Yeah.
Jason and even Manhattan was like late 80s. This is like 1977.
Yeah.
This is.
We have a whole podcast getting set up that is straight up based about New York, like Trash New York, and films from.
Should
trash
have held
New
the York. Carter story for that.
Yeah. Run it over, run them out, knock your pocket, tear your town. Move our corners, move around, talk, don't talk, breaking you down. We are a corporation, we are a company. We cut hard, but we cut not.
So you're next, miss. What do we got?
I'm next. I guess my really lame one is Jurassic Park.
I could see that because that scene with the raptor with almost getting her foot.
The raptor got her
good. Yeah, the raptor got me really good. But like my dad.
You were like 10.
I was 10.
You were 10 years old.
Like we were 12 and 13, I think, when that
13.
Came out.
Yeah,
I was 10 and we saw the first screening of it at midnight. I'd never been to a midnight movie before. And
I saw it the day it came out, but it wasn't at midnight.
Yeah, we saw the day it came out at midnight, and like my dad brought the whole family out. And, my sister didn't even make it past the first dinosaur. Like she was like over it. She ran out of the theater crying. I crawled into my.
It's funny because your sister's my age.
Yeah, I crawled into my mom's lap and I watched it between my fingers. And we got home that night, and he put it. You know, my dad put us to bed, and he kissed us goodnight. And at the time, we were both sleeping with our doors closed. And
not anymore.
After this moment, no, not until I became like a teenager. But
and then the boys started showing up, and the door had to be closed.
Oh man!
Oh
man, I had to hide that training bra. Okay. Anyway, so.
Did you have your own pillow pants?
No, I did not. I probably should have, though. But anyway, so they put us to bed, and about 10 minutes later, my doorknob starts jingling. And there's a roaring sound and claw marks on my door.
Wow. Who did it?
My dad.
What a douche.
And, like, for years. Years, this has been a thing. Me and my sister are terrified. My sister still, I think, is terrified of the movie.
Yeah.
But it's been like the most traumatic thing my dad ever did to the two of us.
He had the night of his life.
Oh, too. I bet.
But I'm like, sure he loved the worst that. Part of it all is that my family were readers. We love books. And, like, you know, I was like Matilda as a kid. Like, it was like, what, you're five now. Welcome to the adult section of the library. You know?
Here's your copy of 50 Shades of Grey.
I read Hound of the Baskervilles.
God, it wasn't like that.
I read Hound of the Baskervilles at like 11.
But so. I was yeah, probably, so did I. But I was probably like 7 or 8 when they handed me Jurassic Park, the book.
Yeah.
And it was like, they eat a baby's face in that book.
They do.
In description. So, of course, the whole movie, I'm waiting for the baby's face to get chewed off, is like really, I think, what really terrified me in the beginning of the movie.
The but only... The ending's different. I know that.
Yeah. No, there's some a fair amount of differences.
Yeah, there's a lot of differences, but it's a lot more graphic, the book, like you said. It's a lot more graphic. It's a lot more fucked up things happen because they're fucking dinosaurs.
Yeah, well, yeah. And from what I remember the books, I've never touched it since. For reasons obvious that are obvious. But it was more, I think, of a book. The book was more like the first and the second.
Yeah. Yeah, they took parts of...
Yeah.
Bits of part two were from the original novel.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because I think it starts off with the dinosaurs are on the island... Are on another island, and that's what eats the baby's face. Then we flash back into how this happened.
Yeah, and that's how part two started? With the little eggs on the beach. Was that the beginning or the end of part two?
This is the beginning of part two.
The beginning of part two, yeah. The eggs of the raptors on the like wash up to a beach or something, and there's some little kid there, and they attack him.
Well, all I know is that... The second book was not good from what I heard.
From what I remember.
But yeah. Jurassic Park. The CGI still holds up to this day.
It's some of the best CG ever done.
Some of the best, really.
Some of the best CG ever made. Like, I don't think it was topped until Lord of the Rings.
If you even watch the Blu-ray of Jurassic Park, because they cleaned it up because it's Universal, it looks fucking great. Yeah,
they enhanced it even more. And as I said, I don't think that 1994 they did... Or 93, they did that CG, and it was not touched again in amazing CG detail like that until Lord of the Rings. I don't think there's any movie in the middle that's anywhere near
I think it was the perfect collaboration of the animatronics and the CG. And I think it was one of the first times. We saw recently,
they said that there was only like 3 minutes of CG dinosaurs in the movie. There's only about 3 minutes of it. The rest of it is all puppets and animatronics.
Yeah. And
the T-Rex chasing them. And it's only about 3 minutes in the entire movie.
Did you ever see the making of where they were going to use claymation for that? And it was the best ever claymation, and it still looked amazing.
Yeah.
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 And that's what I think was Jurassic. It was like, I said, the first R-rated movie I saw was Terminator 2. Mm. You know, it was like, that was my childhood. And I think, like, I'd never seen anything that was so damn realistic.
Dude, both of those movies came out one after another, and it was just like...
Yeah, but you know what? Terminator 2 was a different type of CG. It didn't have to look realistic.
I understand, but it did anyway.
No, it did, but it didn't have to. It was living liquid metal. You don't know what it would actually look like. Yeah. It wasn't based on something realistic.
But the thing is,
you don't know what dinosaurs look like, but you know what lizards look like, and you know how they move. So you basically had to look at a giant fucking lizard. They had some realistic animals to base it on. There's nothing to base a liquid metal robot on. You know, there's nothing to base it on, so you don't have that, oh, well, that skin looks fake and this looks fake. Dude, it's liquid fucking metal.
It
looked amazing. It did. It looked incredible. It was just a different level of reality. It didn't have to look like...
Yeah, it didn't have to look like a dinosaur.
Yeah, it didn't have to look like an animal. It looked like
something that was naturally created.
It didn't have to look organic.
Yeah.
It didn't have to look organic.
Terminator 2, I find it hilarious how CG looked so amazing in 92 and 93, yet it's gotten cheaper but shittier as the time has gone on. Mm-hmm. And then Lord of the Rings came out, and it helped a lot. The Hobbits, even though they're boring as hell, they look fantastic. Mm.
They so. Do. I just, I can't.
Except the Goblin King. The Goblin King and in Unexpected Journey looks like utter shit.
Yeah.
But everything else looks good.
But I think it's like those epic movies that really just bring the best of the best into a, one gigantic collaborative jumble of amazingness. Yeah. You know?
Yeah. I miss good tent poles. Like, even say what you will about Avatar, that was probably the last good, loosely, using the word good loosely, that was the last good tent pole where the story is a basic story, but the movie itself is just like artistic in nature, and there was a giant team of people to put it together.
Yeah.
You know, like the CG in that looked fucking phenomenal too. The eyes on the blue aliens looked kind of fake compared to the rest of them, but the rest of them looked great. So, I mean, I don't know. What do I have for scary? Oh, it's your turn anyway. What do you got? That scared you as a kid.
As a kid, I said Halloween 3. The ending of that.
Yeah.
Always. And the guys, the robots, they were just creepy because it was like...
Droids?
They just weren't... Yeah, they weren't human.
But they looked human.
Super strength.
They were like Terminators.
Yeah, and then the way they moved... The way they moved, like I remember, like the scene when he came, when he comes into her father in the beginning, and he just rips the bridge of his nose out.
Oh my God, that was brutal.
Like just the pure strength that it would take to do that sort of thing, and then he walks outside, sets himself on fire.
I remember that part.
Now the fire itself wasn't. This is, you know what it was, I think, with this movie? It wasn't so much what was happening, but the... And this was true for a lot of... This was true for a lot of 80s movies back then. The effects themselves were not very top-notch.
Yeah.
So...
Plus, the fact that he worked kinda, on a low budget for Halloween 3 anyway.
Yeah. The fact that he... That when it... And the fire went up for that split second. You saw the face, and it looked fake. Made it look so creepy.
Well, they were supposed to be robots anyway. So.
No, I understand that, but it went from being a human to just this dummy. And it was just, but it looked like him. Being a kid, I don't realize that it's like a dummy. It's something fake. It's just suddenly this really creepy face.
Yeah.
Looking at you. You know, or sitting in the car and lighting itself on fire and then going up. Those moments where the effects didn't live up to reality, being a kid, you don't understand the effect part of it. That, it's just a wax dummy.
You just watch it for what it is.
Exactly. So suddenly this thing becomes really, really scary for a moment because it doesn't look natural.
Like anything that like walks away after killing someone and then pours, you know, gasoline, sets itself on fire. You're like, man, if I fall down and skin my knee, I fucking hurt. You know, like fuck that shit. It hurts.
But that's the thing. As a kid, you don't. I don't think that you connect that. It set itself on fire. Oh, my God. You know what it takes to do that sort of thing?
No,
connect
you're right.
That. You don't connect that. It's all about the visual that you're looking at.
But you've just never seen that, and you'll never see it, like, again, in a way.
Yeah, it's like it just looked fake. Like, when Freddy's face comes off in the movie, it looks so terrible. Like, when we look at it now, like, that looks retarded.
But when you're young, you don't understand.
When you're young, you don't understand that
you know
it's
movie?
A fucking monster.
You know what movie did that to me? Spookies.
Spookies.
We talked about Spookies in great detail, so we won't talk about it. The only thing I'll mention, though, is it actually did scare me as a kid, because I saw it when it basically came out, because they played it on TV a few times. We discussed about that, too, how it played it on TV.
Yeah.
And I saw it on USA, and, like, again, a broad daylight movie. It wasn't scary, but just the effects, like, it was gore, and it was a kid getting buried alive, and I like never saw that before.
Like
the Spider Woman. Yeah, like when you're a little kid.
The way she moves, it moves so unnaturally because it's just bad puppetry.
And but that's you're not used to that.
Exactly. You're so looking you're at like, it now as like right now we look at it like it's terrible puppetry. But as a kid, you're just looking
it's
at
it. It's like a monster, a real monster.
It just
monster,
has this
yeah.
very unnatural movement to it, and that's creepy. Like you with the monkeys that took their heads off.
Yeah.
You know? It looks terrible when you look at it like that.
Oh my God,
horrible.
It's ridiculous.
It's yeah. horribly done. But you don't take into account that it's done badly. It's that it's just so unnatural. As yeah. a kid, it's so like that's not how things
that's
move.
That's not how the world works.
Just like the chick
that's
with the crystal
gravity
ball.
Gravity doesn't work yeah. like that. And suddenly, it's just destroying your view of the world because it's moving in a way that you've never seen something move before.
Yeah, and in the Spookies, the chick with the crystal ball and the big tits that we discussed, mm-hmm. how like her head starts pulsating
and
the light.
Opens, and it's like, what the fuck is going
on
here?
Like, she goes from this beautiful girl to this fucking hideous
to this evil
thing.
Dead thing.
And then the big...
She does look like the girl from Evil Dead yeah. in that scene.
And then the golem, like the Grim Reaper thing that just annihilates everybody. Yes. At the end. That's fucking... There's no... No yeah. one lives. And yeah. you're and when you're a little kid, you're like, holy fuck, there's no hero in this movie.
Yeah.
There's no survivor.
Mm-hmm.
And that scares you,
the pretty
of.
Girl almost gets away. And yeah. And then there's the fucking Pee Wee Herman Catman. It just... It's like, yeah, it's like the things look so bad that it actually scares you because you're not used to things looking bad. You know? But, so yeah, like I said, we did Halloween 3. What actually scared the fuck out of me when I was young, and I gave it to you, and you watched it, and you said, oh my God, that is creepy.
Yeah.
The Changeling.
Yeah.
It actually is still... Much like When a Stranger Calls, it's still a creepy movie.
It takes a little while. I'll give it that.
It's a slow burn. It is a slow burn.
Extremely slow
but
burn.
The first moment when you realize something is going, like, this is going to get you, when the piano, bong, all by itself, just that one note plays.
Yeah.
And then there's a whole lot of nothing. And then the ball just comes rolling into the room, and you're like, oh, that's kind of weird, you know? It's just these little things.
The nuances,
And then when you get to the end and you're hearing the pounding of the tub and you're just hearing it echo through the house, and then the wheelchair is moving all by itself and the house sets itself on fire. It's like, this is insane. It's like the Amityville Horror.
The original, yeah. That's another movie that kind of freaks you out if you're a little kid.
Yes.
Yeah.
The voice that the priest hears, the get out!
Yeah.
Easily one of the scariest voices in horror movie history.
Oh, yeah.
Easily. The first time you hear that, it fucks with you so badly.
Yeah.
You never want to hear that voice again.
No. And then when you... The pig kind of destroys it at the end, but... Some people are frightened by it. I laughed at it, and it kind of dragged the movie down for me. But that's just me.
Yeah.
Some people, that's a very subjective scene, though, that last scene. Because you're like, really? But yeah, the voice is bad.
Yeah, the voice with the priest is fucking crazy.
So now we're going to run into one of Lynn's scarier... TV shows.
Why? We're getting away from puppets.
Well, I mean, we all are giant fans of this show, but
yeah.
Why don't you explain what terrified you about this? And this is more into our teen years now.
Yeah, The X-Files was, for whatever reason, it was one of those things that my parents just were like, no. No, really? You cannot watch this.
I watched the first 5 seasons every week of that show.
So did I.
See, I actually caught the reruns.
I was 13 or 14 at the time already when it started. Yeah. So.
I was probably about the same age, but it was after I got my TV in my bedroom. And I could watch it in secret.
Oh, yeah.
So I guess that added like a little something to it. But I mean, first off, the music, the opening, the opening sequence, the chime. Yeah. I just remember watching that, like, just, it freaked me the hell out. But I think with the X-Files, it was, things you never really talked about, like, and these were, like, FBI agents talking about it. It was, like, a voice of authority, and you know, you have Mulder,
and they're admitting that shit goes bump in the night.
Yeah,
they're making it
real. They're admitting that
it's
real. It was, like, They're an FBI agent. Like, they're the freaking wise people. Like, they should know everything. They're the government. They're in charge. And it was like, yes, there's you know, aliens. And, you know, there's this guy who cocoons women up and sucks the juices out of them. And you're like, wait, what? It's like everything that terrifies you as a kid, from, like, bugs to monsters to aliens to mysterious disappearances. And it was like, and two voices of authority, like, yeah, this happens.
The ghost ones were particularly terrifying. Yeah. There were not many of them, but they were fucking crazy. The one with that poltergeist, I think season three had two. There was the one veteran who had no arms and no legs and was astral projecting and killing people. That's kind of, I don't want to consider that a ghost one, but that one was creepy. And then there was the one where the boss was trying to protect the secretary from, his ghost was protecting the secretary from the other boss who killed him or whatever. And, like, he wallpapered, like, his will behind it. It was weird.
Yeah, off the top of my head, I don't remember that one.
I kind of remember that one.
And then the one where they're in some, like, hick town, and there's a poltergeist, and they show the camera footage, and the fucking giant, bright, like, ghost just, like, oh, God, that one was fucked up. I think that was season four, though. That one, the one I'm thinking of. There was a ghost one and the astral projection one in season three. And I think the secretary. Oh no, that was season one. Season one had the secretary ghost thing, because they had a ghost one, and I think every first five seasons. But and then the one where Satan is the teacher.
Yeah,
that one was fucking awesome with the snake that kills the guy.
Yeah.
Then it supposedly eats him, but they never show it because they couldn't pull the effect off for any kind of money.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For any
kind of money. And then it thanks them. The devil thanks them on the fucking chalkboard. I remember that. I like the twins born on the same moment that have, like, powers, because Kathy it was when Griffin. The planets align.
Kathy yeah. Griffin.
That show had that a lot one, of
or
are
you talking about
story.
The Eve? Yeah. You talking about the Kathy Eve. Griffin one or Eve?
The one where the two teenage girls
Eve.
Are born, and they've been best friends, and they start killing boys that they like that reject
yeah,
them.
That's yeah, that's
Eve. You know what terrified me about that one?
One or two?
I think it was two.
I had that bunny. I still have that bunny.
Which
the
one?
Bunny that the
bunny
Eves
that the girls
have.
Had.
Oh.
The exact same stuffed bunny. I have it.
Wow.
Like
the one they used in the show.
The exact one they used in the show.
And it's still haunted by Eve.
Huh.
You may think my name is Lynn, but it's actually... No, I'm just kidding. But yeah, no, I mean, that show, you... I mean, so many different ones. It was like... I mean, even the signal that was driving the town crazy, like, leader...
I loved that.
Oh.
That happens in real life, you know?
Yeah.
Except not that many people. It's usually, like, one or two people.
With yeah.
They did that in Darknet, too.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, I've read up on that, like, way before, and, yeah... That's the conspiracy theater behind Croatoan is the same shit too. The
what?
The Croatoan conspiracy. That's they say yeah. That's the thing they heard that made them go nuts and leave the town.
But that one, I mean, everything, it was so good. I mean, it touched on every freaking fear, and I can't. It was so good. That show was amazing.
The fact that they didn't really run out of stories until about season five or six is. Impressive. I like the computer one too from season one, where it's basically Skynet.
Yeah.
Yeah, that one was good too.
The thing with the reoccurring monsters got me. The like every 30 years, this cycle is, you know, and you're like, is it a serial killer? Is it a monster? Uh-huh. Is it, you know? And you're like, oh my God, this is so much more real. Like now there's an FBI profiler involved and you can profile this thing. And it just made it so much more.
Yeah.
You know, it was a great episode, even though it wasn't that scary. It was more sad. The one with Tony Todd, where he's a soldier, and they make not be able to sleep.
Yeah.
That was slept for 30 up. Years. Yeah. Yeah. And he could control, manipulate people's minds and stuff. Yeah. Yeah.
That's all based on the Montauk Project.
Yeah.
It is.
Oh, God, the Montauk
Project. It's all based on the Montauk Project. There's a soldier who came out last year. This guy who came, he was in the news last year. Literally telling the same story, saying that he was a part of the Montauk Project and the Philadelphia Experiment stuff, The guy was all over the place. You can Google him right now. I don't know his name.
He must be old, right?
He's in his 60s or so, I think, right now.
Okay. Because that was a long time ago. For those of you that...
Oh, my God.
No, it was the 70s or 80s.
Oh, I thought the Philadelphia Experiment was like...
Philadelphia Experiment was started in the 40s.
Yeah.
Started in the 40s, but it ran through like the 70s.
Oh, okay.
The Montauk Project picked up a lot of its... a lot of the experiments.
Okay.
It moved into the Montauk Project. But no, the Philadelphia Experiment that you know is like 1942 or something.
Yeah.
The one, the famous one that they made the movie of.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's 1942. But those experiments continued at the same base. And then the Montauk Project picked up a lot of those experiments and continued them. But this guy said that he was a member of the Montauk Project and MK Ultra program. This dude has some fucking stories. He says he hasn't slept in 25 years.
Huh.
So same story as that. Gets a little fucking crazier though. Like this guy tells stories of how he was they were trained to do a certain thing and they are basically like the guardians of the earth. You know, because the experiments that they're part of were run by an alien race.
Okay.
And he says that he's been to Mars. He fought a war on Mars.
Okay.
Yeah. That there's a Mars station. There's a Mars space station out there. And he actually fought off an invading race of aliens. He was part of the soldier team that fought off an alien race on Mars that wanted to take Mars back. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. There's bases on the moon. He's been to the moon as well because they have teleportation technology and time travel technology. So he's been to the past quite a few times, which is where he met the originators of the Philadelphia Experiment. He was brought to the past and he met them.
Okay.
See, now here's something fucking really weird about all this now.
Oh,
As if it wasn't weird enough. You think that these people are crazy, and maybe this guy's a little crazy too, but did you know that Rob Van Dam claims he traveled through time and met Nikola Tesla in the time portal?
No.
Google it. Rob Van Dam claims he met Nikola Tesla in a time portal. This is like in the 90s or so.
I'm good.
Yeah. That he was, because he's from Long Island.
Yeah.
What, Rob Van Dam?
Yes, he is. Rob Van Dam's from New York.
Okay.
He met him. He lived out near Montauk and they went to the building and him and his friends or something like snuck into the building and he went into an elevator or staircase or something. And when he stepped out, he was in like this void. And a man came to him that he recognized as Nikola Tesla and spoke to him for a few moments. And then he went back and came back to his. So he believes he time traveled back in time, met Nikola Tesla, and then came back.
Okay. He smokes a lot of pot. So.
He smokes a lot of pot.
Yeah. But
he smokes a lot of pot. Like a lot.
Yeah.
A lot. A lot. A lot of pot.
A lot.
A lot.
Well, I brought.
She met him.
I met Rob Van Dam too.
He smells like pot.
Yeah.
No, like because he owns a comic book shop in Manhattan. Did you know that?
No.
Yeah, he owns a comic book shop. So when she worked at the comic book store, he came in a few times, like checking out the competition.
Yeah. I brought that episode up specifically because one of the last movies we have on the list is one of yours, and it features Tony Todd.
Oh, Candyman.
Yes.
Candyman fucked with me for a different reason.
You know what scared me from that movie, real quick aside? The fact that she went to the bathroom and it said shit written in shit on the wall. That freaked me out. I was like,
oh my God.
Do poor people do this? Like, what is going on?
I'm never using a public bathroom again. No, Candyman itself, by itself, really didn't scare me. I've never liked mirrors my whole life.
I knew about the Bloody Mary thing, and that's why Candyman was like...
Yeah, no, that's part of... That always freaked me out, too. I've never liked mirrors my entire life. I've just always... I can't sleep in a room with a mirror in it. Like, it just... I don't know why. Mirrors just freak... This apartment drives her crazy. There's no mirrors in this apartment.
Well, I grew up in
the bathroom has a mirror, and that's it. I don't
He goes to my parents' house, drives him crazy because
there's fucking mirrors everywhere.
Every room in my house was set up so there was a mirror directly across from the bed.
Yeah. It drives me fucking crazy. I can't stand it. I'd rather I sleep in the, when we go over there, I say, well, I'll sleep in the basement. It's a furnished basement, but nonetheless, I'd rather sleep down there. I just don't like mirrors. I sleep with TVs on.
Did you see the movie Mirrors?
Yes, I did. I sleep with the TV on, not because, like, I know a lot of people sleep with the TV on because they just need some idle noise or whatever. I do it because when the TV's off, it's a fucking mirror. And I've always been that way for my entire life. I've just never felt comfortable with mirrors, especially in the room when I sleep. I've never had a mirror in my bedroom. There's no mirrors in this entire apartment other than the bathroom mirror.
And there's a cabinet back there that's not moving, unlike Candyman's mirror.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which was even more terrifying, really. Because it was like, you're afraid of the mirror because it's Candyman. It's the same thing as Bloody Mary, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But then the mirror fucking pops off between the apartments. So it's like, oh, that's even more creepy. Even now there's that's an access.
Really like there's somebody can actually physically come like through the mirror. Like just pop the mirror off and walk right into your apartment.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's even more scary.
That's so fucking creepy. Poughkeepsie Tapes, that was the scariest moment of the whole movie when he was in the closet the entire time.
Yeah.
When they fucked in the bedroom, they went downstairs and he was just standing in the closet watching them the whole time. That's why I did it in Blood Slaughter, because of that. She walks into the room, she comes back out, and then the Ripper steps out of the room she was just in. Like he was just standing in the dark watching her. She walked right past him and walked right back again and didn't even notice that he was there. That's why I did it, simply for that. One thing, you turn the light on, you don't see anybody, you turn the light off, and suddenly he comes out of the room. He could have been in the closet, or he could have come through the window or something. But the fact that she didn't turn the light on in the room in the first place, she could have brushed his shoulder for all she knows. He could have been standing right up along the wall and watched her walk right past him.
Yeah.
You know?
That's fucking... Oh. Yeah. That's giving me the chills just thinking about it now. That's one of the creepiest... like parts of your whole movie is that speaking of things of the dark nature, you know what terrified me the most as a kid? Like, no joke,
I do.
Absolute worst thing that terrified me.
I do.
Was the intro to Tales from the Dark Side.
Tales from the Dark Side.
That fucking music and the random B-roll of outside and nature and
it's just trees, perfect. And then it flips and inverts and it's like the dark side.
Man lives in the sunlit world of what he believes to be reality. But there is, unseen by most, an underworld, a place that is just as real, but not as brightly lit. A dark side. The dark side is always there, waiting for us to enter, waiting to enter us. Until next time, try to enjoy the daylight.
It really was. It was the most nightmarish thing ever.
Yeah.
It was, I loved it. I used to watch Tales from the Dark Side, Monsters, Twilight Zone, and Freddy's Nightmares. They were all on, like...
in a row. Yeah.
More or less in a row.
Channel 11, I think it was.
Something like that. I mean, they probably weren't on in a row. I just remember them being on in a row.
They were all late programming.
They were.
Yeah.
And Tales of the Dark Side was on at, like, 1:30 in the morning.
Yeah, it was late. Yeah,
it was really late, you know, and I was up watching those things. I had my
TV on top of the dresser. Yeah, when you're awake.
You put your TV on top of the dresser, the TV would be like 6 feet in the air. Yeah. You'd have a little tiny TV up there. Laying in bed, my neck is just breaking trying to
watch
this TV set. And then you
have negative fucking forest, negative real forest coming at you with the red, and you're like, oh my God, I'm going to die. This monster's going to come out of... yeah, this monster's going to come out of the fucking TV and eat my face. And then none of the episodes were really that great. And you're just like, oh.
No,
no,
like it was intro. The intro was enough. That was it. You didn't make it past the intro. Just that opening scene. Then you get 4 or 5 minutes into the show and fall asleep.
Yeah. Terrified because of the intro.
Yeah, it's just done. Nightmares for days.
I wish the movie had kept that intro, you know, or something similar to it, but... the show's getting rebooted, and Joe Hill's writing the pilot. So
I know. I can't wait for that.
Wow. I love it.
I can't wait for that. Yeah.
Yeah. And, it was news like a
blast.
Who's
directing? Somebody specific.
Somebody big is directing the first episode.
It was like Mick Garris or something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But hopefully they don't drop that ball.
Yeah, right? That'd be awesome.
It's the CW, so it'll last at least 6 episodes.
Yeah, but it could also be riddled with teens. And,
oh, of course they're going to do that. But yeah, Tales from the Dark Side was what scared me the most when I was a kid, as far as like horror movies. And recently, a lot of people are going to laugh when I say this. Insidious was the only thing that really...
Insidious was so great. It was a creepy movie.
Yeah, it creeped me out when I saw
those
it.
Those smiling...
that kid with the music, oh my God.
Tiptoe through the window.
Yeah, oh. Watching him just
and you
dance.
Knew
yeah.
It was him in the fucking corner, and you think it's one of those little kid corner things. Yeah, that movie.
And she looked through the window and he's doing that. Oh, man, that was so creepy.
Yeah. That movie, a lot of people are like, it was fucking bad, blah, blah, blah.
Because it scared the shit out of you. That's why.
Yeah.
People don't like it when it actually scares them.
Yeah. I fucking love being scared in
too.
Movies.
I love it.
That's how I applaud a movie. It's like, I'm like an adrenaline junkie for scares.
Yeah, when they can't laugh through the scare, man, fuck that shit. Why? Did it hurt your manhood that the movie scared you?
It is. That's totally how it is.
Shit, even Deliver Us from Evil had a few of them, but like...
I had a couple spots, yeah.
Yeah.
I had a couple moments.
Well, I mean, even like working at the haunted house, like, it is true. When you actually scare somebody in the haunted house, they get mad at you.
They do. They get angry that you've hurt their manhood.
And you're like, what did you pay for? The big guys are the worst.
They're the biggest babies.
The biggest babies when it comes to it. Yeah. And I've seen like guys throw their girlfriends at the thing that scared them. Like, they take their waif of a girlfriend and throw her at the monster and back into a corner. And then they come at you like they want to punch you. And you're like...
I have a friend named Mike. We call him Chunk. I haven't talked to him in a long time. But we would love to watch anything with him because... Well, the listeners aren't going to see what I'm about to do, but Manny and Lynn will.
No, he would I feel so privileged. I feel privileged.
He would like sit in the middle between my other friend and I, and we were watching Jaws, and the part where the body comes out of the
boat—it's like a broken fucking nightmare tricycle driving down the. It's like a Nightmare on Elm Street tricycle going down the street.
Yeah, and the body came out, and he went, and he just backed up and pushed us with his hands, and he would do that every time a jump scare happened. Like, he would scream and, like, have a heart attack, and it was
amazing.
That's
what he does to me. Every time a jump scare and I jump 10 feet in the air, he just starts laughing.
The little bullshit gets to me. Like, Oculus had a lot of little bullshit scenes, and that's what got to me. It's not the super crazy jump scares that you're supposed to jump at. It's just like the boom, and you're like, like that's what
like
does
doors.
It to me. Like,
doors, every fucking door, every time they slam a door in a horror movie, I'm jumping like a moron.
Yeah, just the little shit. I'll be whoever I'm watching a movie with. My friend Nicole is the last person I've watched a bunch of movies in theaters with, and we're just sitting there, and she'll just be like, she'll like look at me and be like, was that you? And I'm like, no. Just like liar face and like just me, because like the little stuff, like the no random creak, I'm like, I'll just like have a heart attack. But then when like fucking Katie Sackhoff comes out of the corner with no teeth or something, I'm like, eh, whatever. And then she jumps at it, I'm like, huh, you're dumb.
Yeah. You're like the worst. I'm actually still like that little kid that I was in Jurassic Park, where it's like, oh my god,
she sits
the tension
there,
is building.
She sits there watching the movie, covering her ears and watching through the tops of her eyelids. She points her head down, covers her ears, and looks up through her eyelids and just keeps blinking because the music just fucks with her so much. The music, the sound, the everything. No, not just Jurassic Park. No. In movies in general. When the movie is getting scary, she covers her ears and watches through the tops of her eyelids. She sits there like that.
I have this really smooth
You have cabin fever, girlfriend.
I lean on my elbow and I cover my one ear.
She leans on me. She'll slide over on me on the couch, put her head up against me, and then she'll... And then she'll put her arm up and cover her other ear with her. So my chest is covering one ear and her hand is slickly covering the other.
Because I'm smooth. That's
you know, or she'll put a pillow on the side of her head and just sit there between me and the pillow.
Take my hair down and like brush my hair.
Oh, yeah.
She sits there.
She like did the T-Rex arms just now. Speaking of Jurassic Park. T-Rex arms.
I think that's going to do it for this week on Mario Likes Movies.
Yeah, we kind of stuck to the subject for once.
This was impressive. I like it.
Yeah.
You know?
See, we can do it in person.
We can do it in person. Look at that. Maybe we should do this more often.
Yeah, I agree.
And we didn't have to send you to the kitchen this time to call in.
Yeah. No, I think it worked out with the Carter Hotel and all the spooky stuff.
We did miss one. What? Are you afraid of the dark? The opening intro to that creeped me out.
I liked the visuals.
I was too old.
It
didn't get me. I liked
and
the
I was,
visuals.
I was hitting that age when it came out. So I liked it at first, and then I was like, okay, I'm used to it because I'm a man now.
I have three. You guys have 3 years on me, so I was.
You were still a youngin.
Yeah,
you were
still
seven.
Youngin.
You were seven.
So that swing by itself. Oh my god.
I liked the boat better.
The boat. Oh my god. The boat.
The match kind of ruined it, though. If you really think about it. Because it just started and then it goes out and you're like, oh, that's a hand holding it. You know, it's just like, eh. But the boat and the swings were really good.
Yeah.
That's what I want to do with Spies. I want it's that kind of like just leaves and the dark and some kind of shit going on. But it's too hard to film that.
Leaves and the dark and just this shit happening everywhere. Nobody knows what's going on. And everything is dark and creepy. And there's some wind and some fucking guy in a house somewhere.
And there's something in the fog.
There's that dead in the fog.
Yeah.
There's something in the fog.
There ain't no fog banking out there.
In the fog.
So, yes, for Mario Likes Movies, I am Ryan Gosling.
I'm Nathan Grantham.
And she is busy looking at her phone.
Busy looking at my phone.
And we'll see you next week.
I am not Eve, but I have her bunny.
Mm.
We'll see you next week on Mario Likes Movies.
Yes, but before that, you should be sure to check out...
Oh, wow, I forgot about that part.
Yeah.
We got a plug.
Yeah.
No, plug.
Plug.
You'll see us in one way, shape, or form at Chiller Theater. At least I will be there handing out Episode Zero DVD things, maybe.
Maybe. Maybe.
Yeah. Just to, you know, get that up and going.
Yeah.
And then, these two knuckleheads might join me for Saturday. Maybe.
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 Baby.
Email us at Mario.
Oh, yes. Mail call.
Mail call
us.
Email us at mario.likes.movies@gmail.com.
The more offensive,
good,
the better.
The bad, the ugly.
So,
the
yeah.
Tinder.
You with the Tinder still.
You with the Tinder.
I haven't opened that shit in like 2 weeks.
I haven't even downloaded it.
You don't need to.
I don't.
I don't need it either.
So that's why I said you with the Tinder.
I don't even know what it is.
I'm surprised I didn't.
You don't
want to
know.
Yeah, no. I'm surprised I didn't open it in New York because obviously that's the best place to open it.
Apparently.
because that's when you get all the fucking freaks.
That's, well, it's New York, so maybe you get a response from the Carter Hotel.
Oh, maybe.
That would be pretty
cool. But I'm not looking for dates on Tinder. I'm looking for entertainment.
Looking for the Carter Hotel.
Yeah.
Yeah. So follow us on iTunes and Stitcher and YouTube.
Preferably Stitcher and iTunes.
But yes, preferably.
Check out our podcast on YouTube.
YouTube is actually quite a pain in the ass. Have a good week. We will see you. We'll see you next week on Mary Likes Movies. Stay scared, everybody.
Yeah, try not to shit your pants too much. Or think about Nazi lobsters.
Just shut up.
I hope nobody comes through your mirror.
Just shut up, Mario.
He kills you.
Creature in your attic.
The phone call's coming from inside the house.
The fog in your attic.
Get out of the house.
The fog is coming from inside your house in the attic.
Oh, my God.
It's coming from my attic.
The fog is calling from inside your house.
Specifically your attic.
You answer the phone and just smoke comes out. What is this?
And then it turns into a giant mirror.
It looks like this.
Yeah, they can't see that.
Yeah, I forgot.
But they heard the douche vape, so it's good.
Oh, Jesus, the douche vape. Good night, everybody.
Bye.